So a couple things that I still just can't figure out, and that is, why would Steven Avery kill someone after getting out of prison for serving 18 years for something he didn't do? Why would he risk his freedom, his newly adjusted freedom, and go and then kill someone? Especially considering he was looking at getting reportedly millions of dollars from, you know, suing the former police chief, the former prosecutor, all that. So he's looking at getting a ton of money. He just got out from serving 18 years. Why would he risk all that and go and kill someone? I don't know, just none of it really makes sense. And so, like, a small part of me is like, man, was he set up twice? What, was he convicted twice wrongfully? What's up, guys? My name is Harmon. Today's video is all about Steven Avery. And many of you who have seen Making a Murderer on Netflix know exactly who I'm talking about. If you never saw that, I will fill you guys in on who Steve Avery is and what happened. So in 1985, Steven Avery was found guilty and convicted of a rape and attempted murder. In 1985, and he ended up serving 18 years in prison. The catch was, he didn't do it. He was wrongfully convicted and spent 18 years in prison from 1985 to 2003. They finally found some DNA and found out that Steven Avery was not the one who committed the rape and attempted murder. So Steven Avery was about 23 years old at the time. So July 1985, that was the date of the brutal rape and attempted murder of the lady named Penny Berntsen. Penny was jogging on a beach not that far from here, just a little north of Two Rivers, Michigan. Steven Avery was 40 miles away in Green Bay at the time, but because Steven Avery had some prior arrests and because some witnesses gave a description of the perpetrator, police in the area thought that Steven Avery could have been the one who did it. So they actually added Steven Avery's photo to the photo lineup so she could pick out the guy who raped her and attempted to kill her. So unfortunately for Steven, Penny picked out his photo in the lineup. And so he was subsequently charged and arrested for that particular event. He was given 32-year sentence. So if they didn't find any new evidence or DNA, Steven Avery could have been in prison this entire time. Thankfully, they did find the new evidence that showed that he did not commit the rape and attempted murder. So he ended up serving 18 years out of that 32-year sentence. So he was let go, thankfully exonerated of those crimes. But unfortunately, he spent 18 years of his life in prison for something he didn't do. If you thought that was bizarre, it gets even more crazy. So about a year and a half to 2 years later, Steven Avery, out, free guy, is found guilty and convicted of murder. And this time, he's staying in prison. It looks like he actually did commit this murder. So in a span of a year and a half or so, Steven Avery was exonerated from attempted murder and rape he didn't commit, only to be rearrested and convicted of another murder in 2005. I cannot believe this. It sounds like a complete made-up story for like a movie idea. As of this moment, Steven Avery is still in prison for the new murder he apparently committed. So after Steven Avery was let go and exonerated from prison in 2003, he was attempting to sue, I think, the city, maybe the prosecutors, basically everyone involved in the case. I think he was just trying to sue whoever he could. So Steven Avery actually filed the lawsuit himself, and I think he was asking for somewhere in the neighborhood of $30 million. Unfortunately for Steven Avery, he never received that money because, again, he was convicted of this new murder. Again, there's a lot of conspiracy theories out there. Happened on October 31st, 2005. So Halloween night, a photographer named Teresa Halbach went to Steven Avery's residence, which was a combination of a house and a wrecking yard. So Steven Avery and his family, they owned basically like a whole entire wrecking yard where they had tons and tons of cars, obviously, that they bought and would wreck and so forth. So his house and the wrecking yard was all kind of on one big giant piece of property. So Teresa Halbach went over to Steven Avery's place because Steven Avery's sister was trying to sell a minivan. And so Steven was trying to help her out and try to get a photographer there to take, you know, decent pictures of the minivan, so that way they could put the minivan up for sale on autotrader.com.
So my first question to you is, how did you know Teresa?
Well, Teresa used to come out with here all the time, take pictures of my vehicles, and to put them in the book.
Okay, so how long have you known her?
I've been using the book for a little over a year, maybe, somewhere in there.
And when she came out here, was she all business? What was your personality like?
Same thing every time. You know, hi, how you doing? You know, mostly that. Say about 5 minutes, and out she goes again.
So how did you first hear that she was here?
When the cops came up at the house by my mom and dad, and they asked me if she was out here and that, and I said, yeah. And then they asked me what time, around 2:30. You know, that's what she mostly comes out, you know, 2:30. Sometimes, one time it was at 3 o'clock.
If they asked you to take a polygraph, would you not? And why?
I got nothing to hide. They want me to, but I don't care.
How long were the officers here today, and what were they looking for?
They were looking for my car and that, and flatbed.
Another statement.
And from my family, statements and everything else again.
What are some of the questions the officers have been asking you?
What time has she been there? You know, what she all do when she left? You know, which way she go? Then they they go with the junkyard and where everything is and what do you do and all of that stuff.
So the evidence. They found tons of evidence linking Steven Avery to this new murder. Halbach's minivan was found there, left partially concealed. There was blood stains that matched Steven Avery's DNA in Halbach's vehicle. They also found a burn pit on Steven Avery's property that they found bone fragments that, of course, belonged to Teresa Halbach. They also found Halbach's key, her vehicle key, in Steven Avery's bedroom. So if you add all that up, they found Halbach's car on the property still. They found her bone fragments on the property, and they found the key to her car in his bedroom. Of course, with all that evidence, they promptly arrested Steven Avery. He was convicted of Halbach's murder, kidnapping, sexual assault.
And just, they always saying, I was the last one to see her, which now I find out that I wasn't. It was somebody from Green Bay or near Green Bay that seen her after that. I don't know. See, that don't make sense. If she seen somebody from Green Bay, how did the vehicle get back? This got me puzzled too. I don't know.
So once again, Steven Avery pleaded his innocence and again stated that he was set up, and he gave many reasons why he thought so. Some of the blood that they found, Steven Avery thought that some of the blood was planted with his own blood, because mind you, they tested his blood back in 1996 in order to kind of match his blood up with the other rape and attempted murder. So they had his blood on file. So Steven Avery stated that they took his blood and planted it in the crime scene, since they already had his blood available. At trial though, they had FBI experts test the blood, and they noted that it came from an actual body and not like a test tube. They had a special chemical that could determine if the blood came from like a test tube that was stored blood for a long time, or if it came just straight from like a body. And they determined that it came basically straight from a body, meaning that it came straight from Steven Avery, right then and there, not from a test tube 20 some odd years ago.
They knew I didn't do it the first time, you know. So now it's going all over again. You know, this time, they might get me, they might not. Well, it depends. If they send me up, I ain't hard to plant evidence on you. There's one thing I gotta worry about.
Is there still that fear in your mind that it's like a nightmare that's coming back over?
Oh, yeah, and, yeah. Oh, that's okay. All the time.
Talk to me about that a little bit.
Well, after the first time, you know, it seems like I'm going all over it again, and I'm going to worry, you know, what's going to happen, and they're going to arrest me, and they're going to plant all the evidence. You know, I ain't been home. They've been searching. You know, how hard is it to put evidence in the house or on the property? They served the whole sheriff without to give me the first time. How do I know he ain't got nothing to do with it this time? You know, I don't know.
Any idea? I mean, have you talked with the rest of the family? Is there any idea how that car might have ended up back there?
Don't know. Nobody knows. You know, Thursday night, me and Chucky, my brother, we had to go to Menards, pick up some wood to burn up. But then I seen taillights back by me. So I told my brother, turn around. So we went, I looked, took the flashlight out of the flatbed and shined all over by my place, but I didn't see nothing.
But you think there was a car back on your property sometime?
Yeah, sometime Thursday night. Well, I see taillights. Taillights don't come from nothing, you know.
Do you think that the police are checking over everything of yours in an effort to clear your name, or do you feel like they're trying to finger you as a suspect?
Probably as a suspect.
Do you feel like your people are unfairly pointing the finger at you?
Yeah. Because now they got everybody involved, my whole family. You know, they pull them over, they take them to jail, and they question them, and you know, they give them a rough time. So then I just call it quits. I just forget it.
Do you think there's somebody out there with that vehicle back on your junkyard and trying to frame you?
Yeah.
Does that worry you?
Yeah. Yeah, well, somebody had to put it back there. If I seen taillights and my brother seen headlights, well, where are them vehicles? That had to come somewhere. Lights don't show up just like that. Don't know.
Apparently, there were some of the friends of this missing woman's who found it back there. There was nobody from your family even knew it was back there. You got so many cars, that's not out of the question though.
Yeah.
Did they find anything while you were out searching?
I'm not really going to comment on that, but if anything was found, you know, we had proper authority and professionals take a look at it as they needed.
How many times were you on the site tonight? You were there Saturday when they found the car, but how many other times were you on the site?
I wasn't on the site. That's not true at all.
Did you get their mic? Were you part of the on the site search?
We have no. The people, I mean, the original, when we originally found the vehicle, was a member of our search party.
It was a member of our
who
search party.
Asked for permission to go onto the site, but no one other than that has ever been on the Avery.
On the actual site, it's been crime scene and taped off, secured.
Although, in a weird twist of irony, if he did end up serving that full, 32-year sentence, Hallback would still be alive. So, it's kind of a catch-22, if you know what I mean. Again, it's a terrible, terrible thing all the way around. Alright, so I'm walking on this little pathway to the beach. So if you're curious, Two Rivers, Wisconsin, where the initial rape and attempted murder of Penny was. Two Rivers is as far east as you can go, Wisconsin. It's like northeast Wisconsin, pretty far north of Milwaukee. But Steven Avery's house and wrecking yard area is another, I think, hour and a half north. So again, I'll get there when I get there, but so this is the beach, guys, behind me. This is where Penny, of course, was almost killed. Thankfully, she wasn't, but this is where she was jogging down this beach. And again, at that time in 1985, Steven Avery was well known already to law enforcement. He had prior arrests, and again, the person who committed the crime looked very similar to him. Both had like scraggly beards, both were roughly around the same age, same height, and all that. So I guess it's easy to understand why Steven was picked out of the lineup and why they thought he did it. It's like he was given an opportunity for a new life, and then he, of course, ruined it. So this is where Steven Avery's house was, and where his wrecking yard, salvage yard, was. And I guess I shouldn't really say was, because it's still kind of underneath the family name. But obviously he doesn't live there anymore, and he doesn't own it anymore. But this is where he lived, and his salvage yard is. What makes this case even more bizarre is the fact that Steven Avery's nephew, Brandon Dassey, who was 16 at the time, he confessed to helping Steven kill Teresa Hallback. And so even though Steven Avery is pleading his innocence that he didn't murder Teresa Hallback in 2005, his nephew admitted and confessed to helping Steven not only kill her, but also to dispose of the body. But now that Brandon Dassey has been in prison since 2005, he's now 30 years old, he is now pleading his innocence and has been wanting to get clemency, to get pardon from the governor. He hasn't gotten that yet, but him and Steven now both proclaim their innocence. So this whole story is just, it gets like weirder and more bizarre by the moment. But anyway, so down there, of course, is where the house and the salvage yard are. It is open to the public, meaning you can go there and get car parts and stuff. But out of respect for the Avery family, I'm just gonna stay here by the road and the sign. They don't want anyone poking around with cameras as of 2020. Brandon Dassey and Steven Avery are both still in prison. So a couple things that I still just can't figure out, and that is, why would Steven Avery kill someone after getting out of prison for serving 18 years for something he didn't do? Why would he risk his freedom, his newly adjusted freedom, and go and then kill someone? Especially considering he was looking at getting reportedly millions of dollars from, you know, suing the former police chief, the former prosecutor, all that. So he's looking at getting a ton of money. He just got out from serving 18 years. Why would he risk all that and go and kill someone? Someone that he just met, basically, who was just coming there to take pictures of the van that he was trying to help sell. It just none of it really makes sense. And so, like, a small part of me is like, man, was he set up twice? What, was he convicted twice wrongfully? I would just find it hard pressed to believe that he was wrongly convicted twice for two different things. But then part of me is like, why would he commit a murder after just getting out and expecting a ton of money from the state? It just, none of it really makes sense. That's just my take on it. I'm not gonna give much more opinion on it. Of course they found tons of evidence at the farm across the street. Anyway, if you have any other comments, suggestions, or opinions on Steven Avery, or any other cases that you want me to go film for you guys, please let me know. I'm trying my best to find and film as many different interesting cases or crimes for you. So if you like this kind of content, make sure you hit the subscribe button. And until next time, thank you for watching, guys. My name is Harmon. I'll see you guys on the next one. Take care.
What would you say to somebody who's watching this tonight and who's watching television? And I'm sure there are people out there that say, you know, gosh, this is suspicious. We think he did it. What would you say to people who are asking questions like that?
I'd have to say, I didn't do it. If I did it, why would I stick around if I'm guilty? I won't. I'd be running. I ain't running. I got nothing to hide. You know, they come to me. What do you want to know? I tell them. You want to search my house? I let them in. They searched it, and they left. You know, I got nothing to hide. So what am I supposed to do?
And the same thing up here. They were here.
Yeah, they were here. I gave them the same thing what I always did. You know, now they're trying to, I don't know, put stuff in the game and everything else, and...